Hi everyone, Paul Wilson here. Going to talk today a little bit about publishing your e-learning or online learning course so that you can upload it to your company's learning management system. So let's get started here. Now, most people just go straight to publish when they're doing this. I like to go through a little bit of a checklist. And what I do is just make sure that everything is set up properly. The reason I do that, of course, early on when I was first working with Captivate many years ago, I would find myself publishing and republishing just to fix all the things that I forgot about before I started, developing courses, that already had this stuff built in. So let's take you through this here. You've got your course built, there's a quiz at the end, and it's all set up. Obviously this is just a demo file here, but we'll use this just to make things easy. Now I would go into, as part of my checklist, instead of running straight over to the publish button here, I go into the edit drop-down menu and go into preferences. Alternatively, you can hit Shift F8 to bring into the preferences here. And the ones that I'm concerned about are not so much the general settings, although, you know, it's probably good practice to go through and make sure all your general settings and defaults are set up before you start building your Captivate courses. But at this stage, let's assume that I've already done that. Now, of course, the recording section has to do with creating software simulations, much like this one here. And, the idea is that, if you want the sound of keystrokes and you want a mouse to be visible and all that stuff. Really, the areas that we're going to focus on are the project and the quiz areas. So first off, let's talk about information. Here's where you put information that's going to be embedded in the course. Who the author is, presumably it's you, the company you work for, email, web address, copyright information, that's important if you want to protect your intellectual property, project name, and a description of the course. Incidentally, there's some good information that appears on the screen, the time of the course, the resolution. I like to make my courses nice and small if possible, because obviously different people have different devices, so 800 by 600 seems to work nicely across most platforms. You're going to want to choose the slide quality. The default is to retain the slide quality. This default is typically 8-bit, which is kind of low quality. You'll lose a lot of color information and photographs won't look very good. So I always make sure that it's set for the highest quality possible. I don't worry about the other settings, they're fine. My publish settings I look at next. The default is pretty much what you see here right now. But if you're having trouble with courses, like if you've built a really large course, there's a lot of elements in there, and it's taking too much time to load, or if it's actually crashing when you try to run the course from your LMS, you may want to externalize some of the resources of the course. So this creates anything like skin or widgets or animations. It puts those as separate flash files to reduce the size of your overall main course. At the start of the end, you can have it do certain things, like you can have it auto play, and there's some options there. Auto play could be like you could choose different images to appear. I don't use this option, so I just leave that unchecked. And then autoplay to autoplay the course. The preloader is something I do play around with. The default preloader in Adobe Captivate is, I can show it to you here by right-clicking on it and clicking open. As you can see, it's basically an advertisement for Adobe Captivate. I prefer choosing something else. There's lots to choose from, but a neat little tip I can tell you is if you right-click on any of these files, you can just click open and see them in a little flash window here. So you can choose any of these that you prefer. There's pretty much one for every situation, a rotating globe. A cyclist is one of them. Dots loading is another you can choose. It's just sort of, you know, whatever you prefer, whatever looks nice with the rest of your course as well, and maybe choose something that's appropriate for the branding of the company that you work for. Generally speaking, though, I go with simple. And the default preloader that's right underneath default, if you open that up, it's just a very simple green little circle that indicates to the user that your course is loading. So that's fine. Whatever you choose is okay. Preloader percentage, I always keep that at 100. I've experimented at having the course launch before the entire course is loaded with numbers like 20% or 30% or 50%. And I've had some problems with that in the past, not always working so well. So I keep it at 100%, which means the entire course needs to load into the client memory, the user's memory, before it starts running the course. And that means there might be a few seconds delay before starting the course. But believe me, my experience has taught me that that's probably worth it. You can choose things like fading in and fading out at the beginning and end of your course, and what happens at the end of your course. You could open a URL or a file. For example, you might open a job aid at the end of the course for people to have a record of what they learned. Also, you could actually link to, in a new window, you could link to a website where you collect survey results. So if you want to find out what your students thought of your course, and you can have that open in a separate window, as I've done. You can choose the current parent top, or in this case, new, to launch maybe the company's website. It doesn't really matter what it might be. It can be anything. So in the quiz section, we want to make sure we're set up for the appropriate standards that your learning management system works with. And to find out what these are, you just need to partner with the coordinator for your learning management system, whether it's an administrative assistant or possibly the manager of the department. They'll know, of course, how to set this all up. But you just need to really find out whether you're dealing with SCORM 1.2, SCORM 2004. These are just learning management standards. AICC, which stands for the Aviation Industry Computer-Based Training Committee, if I remember correctly. A little bit rare, but possibly out there. And then TinCAN, which is kind of like, the new SCORM, if you will. So you're going to want to set things up here. I start with the default template, and then I just make sure, what are the standards that we want to follow here. So does someone pass this course or show as complete just by looking at it, or do they need to actually pass a quiz? If you're like me, most of my courses, you have to pass a quiz. So otherwise, you wouldn't choose this. You would choose passed, failed. And what's the criteria for pass failed? User access, that could be all it is. You could uncheck this, and just by opening the course, they've passed. Or you could get more specific and say, no, I need them to view at least half of the slides, let's say 50 slides out of 100. Or, maybe also they need to pass the quiz. And the quiz score to report can be reported in either percentage or points. I recommend percentage because then there's no confusion there. Share the interaction data with your LMS. Recommend that as well. So if you have preliminary knowledge checks or activities for them to perform before the actual quiz is written, you may want that information in future reports. So include that as well. LMS initialization text, it could just simply be something like loading dot 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 is what I use. Now under this advanced button, there's one thing that's usually checked off. It's never send resume data, and the reason that that's checked off is you want to have the user to be able to launch the course, take half of it now, and then maybe tomorrow launch the course again and take the remaining half. So that you would leave that unchecked if that's what you wanted to do. It's a little confusing the way it's written here. So in this case, if I launch the course a second time, it will remember that I was on slide 20 of 40, let's say, and it would take me to that same spot. The reason I check it off, never send resume data, is that I've had problems with this in the past. In fact, more often than not, the people who've left my course early have done so because of a technical problem. So rather than returning them to that same technical problem every time they launch the course, I'd rather them start at the beginning. And the way I design my courses is that you can click on a topic and then a specific slide number, and within literally two clicks, return yourself to where you left off anyway. So that's what I do with that particular setting. Underneath quiz settings, you can choose things like shuffle the answers, you can make the course branch aware, show progress, which is like, question 1 of 20, that sort of thing. It can be relative, which is what I mean when I say 1 of 20. You can allow backward movement. I actually prefer to turn this off so that there is no back button, because sometimes that confuses people. And of course, show the score at the end of the quiz. You can change your quiz result messages. So, congratulations, you passed the quiz. Sorry, you failed. You can have an email button. And you can check off which information you wish to share with them. Like, for example, you may want to simply show score, maximum score, number of correct questions you could turn off, total questions, accuracy, and then maybe you don't want to show quiz attempts. So you can do stuff like that. It customizes the way your course will look. And pass or fail will determine what the actual passing score is. So maybe you need to achieve 80% to pass, whatever. If the passing grade, what would you like the course to do from here? Well, you can have it do nothing, as I've done here, or you can have it do any number of things, including execute advanced actions or run some JavaScript, or you simply could, have it continue. That's an option as well. I usually just have no action. And if it's a failing grade, how many times do you want them to try? So, you can set it for 999 or infinity. But I prefer 999 because then I can choose what the action will be. So show a retake button, and then you can have that retake button do any number of things, as you can see here. A common thing to do would be to have it jump back to slide 1 and start the course all over again. That's pretty much it. There is default labels, but I would recommend that you would set these up before you start designing your course. However, you could change them at this stage. This will be things like, when you get a message from your quiz questions that say, correct, you got the answer correct, click anywhere, press Y to continue, and so on. So that's all done. I've sort of gone through my preferences checklist to make sure the project and the quiz are all set up appropriately. So I'm just going to hit OK there. And now I'm going to do the publish process. So I'm going to click on publish. There are three options here. I can publish to my computer, which is what I want to do if I want to create a package file for my learning management system, or LMS. I can also publish for devices. This essentially turns your course into an app that can be loaded onto a mobile device. And then, of course, the third option, I can publish to Adobe Connect if you have an Adobe Connect account. So in this case, I'm not doing it for them. I'm not making a mobile app. I'm not making a course for Adobe Connect. I am publishing for my company's LMS. So I'm going to hit Publish to Computer, and this Publish to Computer window will pop up. And I'm just going to hit the More button right now so we can see all the options that are available on the screen. And let's start at the top. We're going to publish this course as not as a video. If you wanted to do that, you could create a video and upload it to YouTube. Or again, you could make it a self-running course that would run on Windows by choosing executable. But we're going to go with traditional e-learning will be either Shockwave Flash, SWF, or HTML5, which is the latest version of the web standard. So we'll go with that. Give the course a project title if it doesn't already have one. Where do you want to publish to? I usually use my desktop because that gives me access to the published file very easily. The only thing I recommend here is don't really publish to external drives like thumb drives and things like that. I've run into problems with that before. The output format is up to you. If you've got users who are using traditional PCs, and when I say traditional PCs, like maybe they're only running two or three years ago's version of the browser on their computer, probably want to stick with Flash for now. Even though the new standard is HTML5, not everyone's computers are up to date for that. But you can choose either or as you can see here, both. I'm still, in the organization I'm currently doing work for right now, Shockwave Flash is still the better choice for me, so I'm going to stick with that. I choose the minimum player requirement. In this case, Flash 10 makes sense because that gives me the widest possible number of users to run my course. I'm going to force republish on all slides. I don't have to do this. What it can do is it can write over the old file if I'm republishing and only save the changes. But since it takes so little time to publish from Adobe Captivate, I figure it's a good best practice to just republish everything. I don't choose scalable HTML content. What that does, if I am publishing for HTML5, it can allow the browser to be resized, and therefore the e-learning gets resized as well. Seamless tabbing works with Internet Explorer. It has to do with accessibility standards. You can check that off if you're taking advantage of that. And down under the More section, let's just click that again to remind you that that's not always open by default, you'll see some other settings which really, quite frankly, from going through that preference checklist that we've already done, should already be set properly. Things like resolution, size and quality, we did that. Accessibility is turned on, yes. And e-learning output, of course, we chose SCORM 1.2. So we're pretty much good to go. At this point, you just click the Publish button, and you'll see some progress bars across the middle of your screen here, letting you know how it's done. You just sit back and wait for this to be completed, and you'll get a message saying that Publish is completed successfully. So what we should have now is a little zip file right on my desktop. So I'm just going to minimize Adobe Captivate for a second, and sure enough, there it is. This is the file that you're going to upload to your LMS, your learning management system. Don't take anything out of it. Don't unzip it and put certain parts of it in different places and things like that. Just keep it as it is, and when you're ready to build the course on your learning management system, this is the element that you need to upload. And if someone else does the upload to your learning management system, copy this file as is to a thumb drive and take it over to them. That's pretty much it. So if you guys have liked what I've done for you here today, provided you some good hints and tips about publishing in Adobe Captivate 8, please give me a thumbs up. I really appreciate those. And if you want to see more videos like this one here, go ahead and subscribe to my channel. I also really appreciate that. Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.